Penguin Random House Audio presents No One Needs to Know, a novel by Lindsay Cameron. Read for you by Brittany Pressley with Rebecca Lowman. For Ethan and Elise, always the favorite part of my day. If you want validation, use your social media. If you want discretion, then turn to Urban Myth. Your secrets are safe with us. Press release, Urban Myth app launch. It was lauded as an alternative to the performative, show your best self platforms, an anonymous social media app organized by neighborhood. All you needed to create an account was an email. No profile, no username, no way to track your identity. The anonymity worked like truth serum. We disclosed things there we would never discuss with our best friends or even our spouses, especially not our spouses. We bared our secrets. It was supposed to be confidential. And it always was. Right up to the moment when it wasn't.
Prologue. Before it happened, I never noticed how many times a day an emergency vehicle drove past my apartment building. Their sirens blended in with the cacophony of New York City, an ambient noise that never roused my attention. Today, though, I knew with absolute certainty that the wail emanating from the street below was the second police siren I'd heard in the past 6 hours. Instinctively, my ears now detected the shrill sound, the way a deer detects the snap of a twig beneath a hunter's boot. A signal of imminent danger. My body stilled, attempting to clock the proximity of the vehicle. Louder, closer, louder, closer. I wiped my clammy palms on my cotton pajama bottoms, my mind cycling through wild scenarios. Fists pounding on the door, weapons drawn, the stupefied expressions of my neighbors. Did they say murder? They'd whisper. I pulled at the soft fabric on my upper thigh, debating whether I should change. If I was going to be perp-walked, I didn't want to be wearing the same pajamas I'd donned for the past 3 days. Pushing myself off of the couch, the sound of the siren finally began to recede. I released a ragged breath and dropped back down. Another bullet dodged. Leaning forward on the cushion, I slid my laptop closer to the edge of the coffee table. The screen had gone black. I tapped the trackpad to bring it back to life, and the homepage of the New York Post stared back at me. Anxiety thrummed my veins as I scanned the familiar headlines. In the long list of issues I hadn't considered when I'd pressed 2 fingertips against the fleshy neck of the lifeless form, confirming what I already knew, the ensuing media attention had to be at the top. But the news cycle was the furthest thing from my mind when I was staring down at the slack, ghostly face, the milky white eyeball bathed in red. Among the many feelings jostling inside my body in that heart-stopping moment, the fear, the horror, the shock, there was one, quiet but persistent, that took me by surprise. It was relief. Because maybe, just maybe, you got what you deserved.
Chapter 1. February. Heather. As the black Escalade inched down Park Avenue, Heather had the feeling she was being slowly marched off a cliff. She imagined a loud, male voice behind her bellowing out the orders, left, right, until she plunged blindly over the edge. Was it her husband's voice she was hearing in her mind, or some generic movie voice, like Morgan Freeman's? It had to be the latter. If her husband had his way, she wouldn't be sitting in this car right now. Are you sure this is a good idea? Oliver had repeated, as she'd pushed her feet into the ballet flats beside the door, his brow crinkled with concern. Yes, she was sure. So why wouldn't Morgan Freeman shut the hell up? Heather leaned her head between the seats, peering out the windshield at the river of illuminated red taillights, a mocking reminder of how little control she had over the evening. Can you take Lexington instead? This doesn't look like it's moving. If she was going to be marched off a cliff, it should at least be efficient. The driver tapped the dirty iPhone mounted on the dashboard.
Waze says park is better, but whatever you say.
The car swung left and she slid back on the seat. She could already see the traffic was lighter on Lex. The knot in her stomach uncoiled a bit. A good omen. She could use one of those. She put her hand on her daughter's arm and gave it a reassuring squeeze. It'll be more fun than you think, I promise. You and I have very different definitions of fun, Violet muttered, not bothering to raise her eyes from her phone. Heather's jaw clenched. There were kids right now who were weeping to their parents because they couldn't get a ticket to this event. Yet here her daughter sat acting like she was about to spend the evening being waterboarded. The driver jammed his brakes at the light, and an expensively clad woman holding the hand of a curly-haired toddler stepped off the curb, lifting up an open palm to the cars, as if she had the power to stop traffic. Heather followed them with her eyes, feeling a pinch of nostalgia for when Violet was that age. Always at arm's reach. How easy it was to guide her through life back then. Organic food, music classes to stimulate her brain, teaching her to go down a slide rather than walk up it. There was a playbook, a comprehensive step-by-step guide that made perfect sense to Heather. It's easy to feel like a good parent when you have an easy child, the director of Violet's preschool had told a room full of eager parents. But Heather wholeheartedly disagreed. It wasn't genetic luck. Heather had prepared for being a mother the same way she'd prepared for the SATs, meticulously, and it had paid off. Violet could read an entire chapter book before she'd finished kindergarten, had a shelf full of squash trophies, and was a regular winner of the service award at her competitive Upper East Side private school. This type of success didn't happen by accident. Heather was a good mother. Violet was proof of concept. She tucked a stray strand of Violet's cinnamon-colored hair behind her ear. I know this isn't what you want to be doing tonight, but you need to keep your eye on the prize. Violet groaned. You don't even know if she'll be there, Mom. I mean, where did you even hear she was coming? You said yourself it wasn't public knowledge. Violet tore at a cuticle with her teeth, and Heather gently moved her hand away from her mouth. Violet looked like she might protest, but she let her hand fall into her lap. Eye on the prize. Heather repeated, ignoring the question. Again. Whatever, Violet mumbled, plucking a peppermint candy from the pile in the cup holder, twisting open the wrapper and popping it into her mouth before Heather could protest. Heather pressed her lips together. She hated when Violet ate anything offered in an Uber. Who knew where those dirty little candies had been? Some pervert might find it humorous to unwrap them, lick and rewrap, waiting for some unsuspecting rider to partake. Why wasn't her daughter more suspicious of candy from strangers? A suburban, poison and Halloween candy-style paranoia had been drilled into Heather as a child, but she'd somehow failed to pass on a healthy sense of caution to her daughter. She added that to her mental list of things to teach Violet, but not tonight. Heather checked the time on her phone. 6:55 p.m. Damn it. We'll get out here, she said, tapping a fingernail against the window. We're still 5 blocks away, Violet whined as she unpeeled herself from the leather bucket seat. And these shoes you made me wear are really uncomfortable. She gestured to her sensible but fashionable 1-inch heeled pumps, the ones Heather had purchased last week after reading a study claiming people attribute significantly greater intelligence to taller children. While it might not be a fair assessment, who was she to argue with psychology? You'll be fine. Heather waved her out of the car impatiently. The walk will be good for both of us. By the time they swept through the brass doors and into the elegant foyer, most of the children had already descended the scarlet carpeted staircase. They weren't children anymore, Heather supposed. They were teenagers now, all dressed up and ready for their first teen night at the Doubles Club, the private dining club that catered to the elite social set, which Heather had spent years strategizing her way into. It's so overwhelming, isn't it? Heather could remember a perky southern blonde lamenting as she shook a small maraca over her three-month-old in their music babies class at Diller Quail. New York City parenting, I mean. Like, we have to do all these classes to get them into the right preschools, and we have to know about all this stuff like years in advance or our child is shut out. And apparently it only gets worse. She'd leaned in conspiratorially. Have you heard about these teen dances at doubles? My neighbor told me her daughter became a social pariah because they weren't members, so she couldn't go. Heather had arranged her expression to be appropriately shocked, but she'd gone home and straight to Google to investigate. Unlike her southern friend, Heather didn't consider it overwhelming. There was a formula. Formulas she understood. A gaggle of girls congregated at the bottom of the stairs now, teetering like newborn giraffes in heels that were much too high, visibly vibrating with excitement. Heather scanned the preening crowd, hoping for a familiar face she could point Violet toward. A social crutch, but came up empty. Violet needed to make more friends. Although, truth be told, the apple didn't fall far from the tree in that category.
Place your mobile phones in these locked pouches.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.